Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Doesn't matter what time of night or day, I'm still just as happy that you stopped by my channel. Thank you all so very much. If we're meeting for the first time, my name's Reverend Paul J. Bern. I'm the online pastor of the online faith-based community known as the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center, based in Atlanta, Georgia, sending blog posts and videos around the world. This is not a traditional church. That's why I don't call it that. This is a faith-based community of believers that meets online so they can do so from the comfort of their homes or their businesses. You'll find no denominational teaching here of any sort. You will not find one religion as being presented, as being any better than another, as if such a thing were possible. You won't find any political ideologies here either. I steer clear of all that stuff. What you will find is a whole lot of teaching, learning, and sometimes just plain preaching about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who lives and reigns forever, who is even now seated at his Father's right hand, patiently waiting for that cue from Dad that it's time to go and bring us home. And bring us home he shall. You can be sure about that. Pardon my neighbor there with his muffler. Anyway, this Sunday's message is titled, "The Only God That's Real." To find out which one that is, bear with me for a few minutes. I won't keep you an extremely long time or anything like that. And let me tell you about him. It's part of my job description, you see. Like nearly everybody else, I too am appalled by the infighting in Washington over politics, ideology, and religion. They mix all three together there, you know. Moreover, I find all the bickering between the peaceful 90%, which is us, and the war hawks, who are the top 10% in the economy, to be little more than a sideshow considering what's actually at stake, which is the future of democracy itself. I am equally put off by all the sniping and the infighting between religious denominations over man-made dogma and traditions steeped in pomp and circumstance, while they remind everyone constantly to support our troops. They are all in favor of brawling with, and even killing, those who disagree with them, while calling themselves pro-life. It makes no sense. And so, I'm going to depart from that entire train of thought and line of teaching. Tell you about the true God. No one can worship this God and materialism. No one can praise the true Almighty God while being a materialistic person all at once. I will use the scriptures to prove that the one true God is above and beyond all wars, all churches, and organized religion in general, in keeping with the theme of this website, which is our motto, where truth, justice, and the Bible meet. You'll find the link to that on the blog. Right there on the first page, too. The first thing that I want to remind you of is that there are many false gods in the modern world. The most egregious example that comes to my mind is the worship of money and material goods and all the evils that come with them. In the Apostle Paul's first letter to Timothy, Paul wrote that, and I'm quoting here, "The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil." Closed quote. That means money, in and of itself, is not always evil. I don't think it is. Not but in and of itself, but greed and the insatiable lust for more and more money and goods and investments most definitely are. Jesus said in all four of the Gospels, at various points throughout them, "No man can serve two masters. He or she will either love one and reject the other, or cling to the latter while despising the former. You cannot serve both God and materialism." Or you cannot worship, in some translations, God and money. That comes from Luke chapter 16 and verse 13. Is where you can look that up in Luke's Gospel. I think this would apply to, among other things, the sale of military armaments by the United States the United States Military Industrial Complex. This calls for us to begin to get our own priorities straight, never mind all the other stuff associated with war and killing. The love of materialism appears in many forms. Let's ask ourselves these questions. Some of these are going to be difficult questions for some people. Do we sometimes find ourselves in automotive dealerships every time a new model comes out? Do we shop for new clothes, electronics, mobile or smartphones, the latest computers, and new decor for our homes, whether we need them or not, just because they're on sale? Do we sometimes find ourselves shopping for a new house, whether we really need one or not? Are any of us in debt up to our eyeballs, not counting student loans, because we owe too much on our credit cards and everything else? If anyone answered yes to any of these questions, and particularly if you prioritize these things at the expense of your own spiritual lives, then you are worshiping a false god or false gods. Sorry to have to tell you that. I apologize if I hurt anybody's feelings, but not for the reason why. Sorry to have to tell you all that, but truth is truth. And we worship the God who is synonymous with truth. It is Jesus Christ and He alone that must be at the top of our priorities. Anything else takes a back seat to Jesus. in the order of our lives? Most of the things I just mentioned, excluding greed, are not evil in and of themselves. Greed is. But false and futile worship of anything other than the God Almighty, while bypassing or not including Jesus Christ as our Savior, amounts to idol worship. Yes, I did not stutter. Idol worship. A similar line of questioning was presented to the Apostle Paul nearly 2,000 years ago, and it is well documented in the book of Acts in the New Testament. I would begin with a quote from chapter 17, beginning at verse 22, and this will be the last Bible quote for this Sunday's message. Bear with me for about 2 minutes here, because this one is somewhat lengthy. I'm quoting a clarifying and topical quote from the Bible. Then Paul, the apostle, stood up at the meeting of the Areopagus. That's Areopagus. Search that one later. It's the Greek language, by the way. And he said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are religious. For as I have been walking around and looking carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.'" Now, what you worship as something unknown, I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives life and breath and everything else. From one man, he made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps to reach out for him and find him, although he is not far from each of us. As some of your own people have said, and that's another quote, we are his offspring. Close quote. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance. But now he commands all people everywhere to repent. When they heard about Jesus' resurrection from the dead, some of them sneered. But others said, "We want to hear more from you again on this subject." That's Acts chapter 17, verses 22 through 32. Okay. Now, everybody check this out, because I'm really going somewhere with this one today. The real truth about God and his origins. This passage I just read to you is just one of numerous examples of the Apostle Paul's teaching about the one true God. I especially appreciate that Paul made two distinct points about God. The first is that God is above and beyond all nationalities, races, and religions, because he first is that God is above all nationalities, races, and religions, because he preached the same message equally to Jews and Greeks and all other Gentiles. The one true God is also above and beyond all the material possessions that money can buy. These things were considered to be radical teachings at the time, because all these groups believed that their version of God was the correct one, to the exclusion of everything and everyone else. Sound familiar? This very mistake continues to be made today by certain church denominations who I will decline to name. Many of you already know who they are. Nobody has the exclusive path to God. No one has the right to claim that they are any closer to God than anybody else. It's just not true, and it never was. Moreover, nobody has the right to condemn another person's religion so long as their beliefs don't hurt or restrict the freedom of anyone else. And one last thing, we can't buy our way into heaven either. When we die, all that money, the cars, the houses, you can't take it with you. You come into this world naked, and naked you will go out. God, the only God that's real, has an address, which is the heart, mind, and soul of every true believer. That's where God lives. The second point, then, that catches the human eye and captures my imagination from that quote is what Paul said about where God lives. And I'm quoting him here. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives life and breath and everything else. Close quote. What an awesome statement that was. Think about how many religions there are in the world. There are over 4,000 Protestant denominations alone. And that's just in North America. All are called churches or houses of worship, regardless of which religion they represent. And yet God doesn't live in any of them. Instead, for the true believer, God lives in the souls and the minds and the hearts of all individual believers. The true church is portable, too, moving along with whatever task God may assign us. Never mind all the spiritual sophistry that's being taught in some modern churches, because it's all largely based on money. What matters to God? What indeed? God doesn't care who you are, where you live, or what you have done, or not, what country you are from, or what church you are connected with, or not. God doesn't care where you've been, and he doesn't care about what is in your past. Unlike many men and women who attend church regularly, God doesn't care what you look like, or how much money you give to your church, or to charities, or what your social or economic status is. The one true God doesn't even live in churches, although a lot of phony religious leaders and related clergy will no doubt insist that he does. Instead, God wants to live and breathe in our souls, our hearts, and our minds. He wants you to become a church in and of yourself. A church that walks and talks. Not only does God want to live inside you, he wants us all to pay that forward unconditionally. unconditionally sharing our faith with others. Also, to quote the Apostle Paul, God wants us to continually work out our own salvation with fear and trembling before the Lord. That last quote comes from Philippians chapter 2 and verse 12, in case you want to look that up. So, in closing, the true and authentic God, let me add that there is absolutely nothing wrong with going to church, no matter what religion you identify with. If you currently attend, I'm certain that God wants you to continue, so long as you keep hearing messages from the pulpit that are encouraging, uplifting, and positive, and most importantly, that are based on Scripture, the Bible. I don't want this message to be a reason for those who are attending church to stop going. God forbid. On the other hand, please keep in mind that the church is just a building and nothing more. I acknowledge that churches are built as meeting places for like-minded believers and that they should remain so. Absolutely. But now that you have read today's message, or heard today's message, or watched it, I hope that I have given everyone a better perspective, whether in church or out. You can look at organized religion with skepticism, as I do, but do not let that compromise your most deeply held spiritual beliefs. They make them non-negotiable. The one true God is greater than all the religions in the world combined. He is truly above and beyond all. A little correction there, pardon me. Live your life then as a lifestyle. A Christian lifestyle. An authentic Christian lifestyle. Let me bring one up last thing before I go, and I really wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't point this out. If we are going to have God living inside each of us through Christ Jesus, then we should be living and acting as if He did. Watch what you say and how you say it. Clean up your life and the language that you use. Be mindful of anything that you are doing to excess, because this is the root of all addictive behavior. Careful there, everybody. Live your life as if God is watching what you do and listening to everything you say, because He really is. When you're in traffic, drive your car as if Christ is in your passenger seat. Makes traffic a lot less stressful, you know. Until next time, then, be a believer that walks and talks the good example of Christ for others to follow, especially those who look up to you, such as your kids and your nieces and nephews and grandkids, and your co-workers as well, especially if you're in a position of authority. And the most incomprehensible peace, that is the very embodiment of Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, will remain with you all permanently. Amen. Normally, at the close of a church service, this is when they pass around the collection plate or basket, depending on where you're at. I don't have one, because I'm only online. But one thing you'll never hear from me is to tell you you got to tithe 10% of your income to me. I don't do that. But I do need a little support here and there. I do this without pay. I bear these expenses myself. I would like to do some more marketing and promoting of my message, but that costs money, and that's money I don't have right now. But if you can send a small offering, or a large one if you like, we are a registered nonprofit on PayPal. The email address for PayPal is greatestservant62@gmail.com. That's all one word and all lowercase. greatestservant62@gmail.com. You could also donate on Stripe if you prefer. Go to Stripe's homepage at stripe.com. Type into the search box at the top of the page there, Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center. It pops right up. Fill in your amount and send it off. Send pretty much the same way as PayPal. They both work very similarly. I'll be adding other payment programs in the near future as soon as I get done evaluating them. If you are unable to make a donation, another way you can support us that's much cheaper is simply to subscribe to our blog. You'll get 2 blog postings every week plus 2 videos every week at a minimum. The life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and messages about war, poverty, inequality, all of it. Access to my archives too, and you get free access to my YouTube channel. All that for $5 a month or $50 a year. That works out to 16 cents a day. I would challenge anybody to take 16 cents and go around and try to buy something with it. Because you can't. You can't hear. So please sign up if you can. The sign up page is PBERN, that's pbern.substack, substack.com. pbern.substack.com. Or if you prefer, follow me on Medium. I'm over there too. The Medium address is medium.com/ampersand. Greatest Servant 62, just like the email, /subscribe. Feel free to sign right up. There's no money out front except for the first month. You'll have access to merchandise too. My books, my faith-based t-shirts, a line of calendars that's going to be coming out here in another month or so, with nothing but photos of antique car convertibles on them. What do you see these? They'll be a good money-making enterprise for the ministry, and we'll see how it goes. And so, before I go, I want to thank you for each and every one of you for the privilege of your time. You have all been so much appreciated. Having said all that needs to be said for this time around, everybody be blessed. Yes, I said be blessed. In Jesus' mighty name.